at the event about Dr. Vaidhi Reddy, and so I think over time people will come, we'll have people coming in. So it gives me a great pleasure to invite Professor D. Krishna Kumar to give a presentation as part of the Research and Publication Seminar Series. Professor Krishna Kumar had an illustrious career. He taught at IIM Bangalore for several years, and he has a PhD in Economics and Statistics from Iowa State University, and he was the head of the Analysis Unit at the Indian Statistical Institute in Bangalore. And his publication record is exemplary. He has publications in Econometrica, American Economic Review, International Economic Review, Journal of Quantitative Economics, Aristat, Sankhya, Journal of Statistical Planning, among others. I think you'll learn a lot from this talk today. So I'll actually have to leave a little early because I have a class, but I request you to please stay on until the end of the talk. And with this, I hand over the mic to Dr. Krishna Kumar. Welcome, sir.
Thank you, Sanjay. So the topic I chose today is a poverty index with time varying consumption income. The reason why I chose the topic is the topic.
Color map is already there. So
it's not necessary. Okay. So that is the topic we chose for a paper that was published in Physical Reviews in March 2017. You can access that. And that is what I'm going to talk about today. But really speaking, the topic should have been a poverty index without a poverty line. That is the area I have been working on since 1991 with various authors. Okay, this is one version of it that I'm currently working with these two authors. So our basic premise is that there are two ways of defining poverty. One is poverty is something, a quality that the poor have. Only the poor have poverty and others don't have. If that is the way you want to define, then first you have to define who the poor are. Unfortunately, that is the line taken by most economists. Okay. But alternately, there is another line which says that poverty is actually a quality of level of living of low income people. So the level of living of low income people is poverty. Okay, that is another way of defining poverty. And I have been following that from 1991 onwards. Unfortunately, there are very few followers. Okay, that is one of the reasons I take any opportunity like passing through Ahmedabad, or let me see if there could be some youngsters who may be interested. So that is why I am here. Okay. And because of that, what happened is, they assume that there is an identified class of people called poor, and poverty is what they have. So as a result, there was born a mythical straw man, the richest of the poor, is a mythical, it's like the snowman kind of a concept, that it's a mythical man, the richest poor man, who has an income which is called the poverty line. Okay, that is nonsense in my opinion. Okay, I don't know whether any of you have seen this cartoon from R.K. Lakshman, where he says that there is a poor man, poor fellow, his status is never changed. He is sitting there, poor, with a begging bowl. But on the right side is a bureaucrat or a politician. On the left side, there is an academician, a policy scientist called economist, economic advisor to government of India. So he is telling the economist to lower that robe a little bit wide so that the poor fellow can be above it. That is the topic of the cartoon. Okay. Poverty is a measure of consumption deprivation is my approach. Influence is a measure of abundance of resources. In my opinion, both are continuous function of income and level of living. Poverty increases as income goes down. Affluence increases as income goes up. Okay. Where do poverty and affluence, where does one end and the other start? That is something I will answer as I go along. Okay. If you really want to have a demarcation, you ask the question, where does one end and the other start? I will answer that a little later. Very interesting, if you look at the literature, I can classify the literature into three epochs historically. One is the early history of poverty studies. And the first one I would like to talk about, in fact I have been talking that my approach is nothing but an approach in the tradition of Ernst Engel. Engel is the one who started in 1857 and his approach had no poverty line. Okay. And then came Roundtree in 1901, but that was with a poverty line. And Arthur Bowley and Hirsch, that was with a poverty line. Then interestingly, in our own Indian context, P.C. Malanovis, under whose guidance and institute I was brought up, and he has been working in the planning, on planning, second 5-year plan and so on, and he was very much interested on the level of living of the poor. So for that reason, he went to the extent of devising the statistical method for measuring poverty using what is called tactile graphical analysis. And his approach also did not use poverty line. What he did was, he did fractal graphical, that means lower 10%, lower 20%, lower 30%. What is their level of living? And how do you compare that over space and time? That was his intention, and he published an excellent paper in 1960, Econometrica. People ignored that altogether. Okay, all the poverty studies ignored that. And then Professor P.V. Sukhatme, he headed FAO as a statistical advisor to Food and Agriculture Organization of the United Nations. He wrote a paper in Journal of Royal Statistical Society in 1961, where he defined what a hunger is and what are the world food supplies and how can the food supplies be enhanced in order to eradicate hunger was the topic of his paper in 1961, Journal of Royal Statistical Society, for which he got world's highest award in statistics called Guy Medal. And a lot of people ignore that. In fact, he also happens to be the first one who was critical of the poverty line, Professor P.V. Sukhatme. And it gave me a lot of pleasure when I was asked to deliver, after he passed away, P.V. Sukhatme Memorial Lecture by the Indian Society of Probability and Statistics, and I chose Poverty Without a Poverty Line for that lecture. That was published in 2007, Economic and Political Weekly. Then I said there is a medieval history. There is a Mali Arshansi who was working for the Social Security Administration in the US. And she wrote a paper on children of the poor in Social Security Bulletin that was published in 1963. And in the United States also, there is a poverty line. There are people below the poverty line, about 12% in even USA. Okay, all that is based on Molly Arshansky's work. Then Lyndon Johnson, in 1964, when he became the president after Kennedy was assassinated, he came up with an economic policy to eradicate poverty in the United States. So, he called it war on poverty was the slogan. Then of course, Indira Gandhi talked about Garibi Hatao and Desh Bachao, and then V.M. Dandekar and Roth, they came up with a nutrition-based poverty line. It's a very fundamental work in 1971 that they had done. And that has formed the basis for the poverty lines in India. That was a very good study. And then Amartya Sen came in 1976 and he twisted all the poverty research around. Instead of concentrating on how to measure poverty and the level of living and so on, people started following Amartya Sen and went ahead to measure, define mathematically, abstractly, what are the axioms that a poverty should satisfy, and what would be a good measure that satisfies all those axioms. It was gone on to a very abstract level with his contribution. It was very unfortunate. And the modern history starts with first Green and Thorbecke index of 1984, and that one more or less generalized Sen index, head pump index, and all the poverty indices that existed until 1984 into a unified index called Path, Greer, and Thorbecke index. Okay, the Thorbecke happened to be my professor when I was doing my PhD. And then Foster and Sharrocks in 1991 had another index, and where they talked about decomposability of index. That is, you have an aggregate index, but how do you decompose it into components? That was their focus. Then very recently, from 2007 onwards, Alkir and Foster at University of Oxford, they developed what is called a multidimensional index. And it is nothing but increasing the dimensions of the poverty confusion. For poverty index, you have to have a poverty line. For a multidimensional poverty index, you must have as many poverty lines as there are dimensions. Okay. In my opinion, that is another wrong route that people are following. What are various issues with traditional poverty measure? It depends on arbitrary and subjective poverty lines. And another important thing is, we want to alleviate poverty, we want to know who the poor are. And if we use a poverty line as a measure and use below the poverty line, then one of the problems is, the poor people by their very nature have uncertain incomes. So how do you know whether they are below the poverty line or not when their income is uncertain? That is one of the major problems. It is also an indirect measure based on income and not on consumption. Poverty must be related to consumption, level of living, not income. Sometimes even if income is low or high, they consume more or less same thing which is essential to them. So something essential does not vary that much, whereas something not essential would vary. So these are some of the, and another thing is, all the poverty research we see today, it is totally detached from your microeconomics, macroeconomics. Okay, question is, how is poverty related to the economic conditions, market conditions, state intervention? Unless you know that, you cannot introduce measures to alleviate poverty. So that is another basic drawback of the existing literature on poverty. Now, Engel's approach is without a poverty line. And he used what is called a comfort level of income. And then he classified the entire households into three types. Those who are very poor, who depend on external state support or somebody's aid and so on, external support, or those who are at the margin, who can live by themselves with poverty, and then those who have a comfortable level of living. Okay. Interestingly, we found, by the way, we did all our work on poverty without a poverty line without really reading, unfortunately, the original work of Engel of 1857. I feel guilty that when I first started working on it, I did not read Engel's original paper. Of course, I can excuse myself because that paper was in German and I could not read it. Okay. Even today, there is no English translation as far as I know, but if anybody has seen an English translation, please send it to me. I haven't seen the English translation. Okay. his concept of comfort level of income is that income where people spend all their income on consumption. They have no savings. Okay. That means they spend whatever income they have to spend, they spend it. That is the comfort level we used. That's a very good measure. In our recent paper, which is being reviewed by The Nature, which is a scientific magazine, favorably being reviewed, we use that approach. That of zero savings. Even in our physical review paper, last March, we used that measure of a cutoff point where there are no savings, zero savings. Engel, what he did was, he assumed that there are certain basic needs. This is called Maslowian theory. Some of the management students should know that. Okay, Maslowian, there are basic needs. Those basic needs are in a hierarchy. And a person would like to meet the most basic need first, and then the next most basic need, and so on. And then those needs are met by a few commodity bundles. So he classified all the bundles, etc. And then he found that nourishment or nutrition is the basic need. And he measured level of living in terms of food expenditure. That was his contribution. And you may all have heard about the Engel's law and Engel's curve, which was derived from that. Which was derived from his original study on measuring poverty. He found nourishment, the people who are on relief, who get some aid, how much they spend, people who are poor but independent, not on relief, and people who are comfortable. How much they spend on nourishment, clothing, housing, etc., all these he classifies. Then he found that mean income for category 1 is this. Mean income for a second category is higher. Mean income for that is about 1200 francs. And total expenditure is this. And food share of the total income, that is the so-called Engel's law. If you look at the third row, 81.4, 71.5, 63.3, he said the share of food expenditure in total income becomes very high at very low levels of income, and then it starts declining as income increases. That was his observation, and that was his measure of level of living and that of poverty of the poor people of the lowest category 1. Then, as I said, we did not know what Engel did. Yeah. That one?
Yeah, so the expenditure is more than the mean income
for all the categories.
Yeah, yeah, you're coming to that. Okay. Please note that. There are some categories where expenditure is more than income.
Not that is
income. Okay? That's what I said. These are all the people who don't save. Not only save, who has really dissaved in order to spend. That is the wonderful contribution of Engel, and his threshold was zero savings. Okay, these are average, by the way.
Yes.
There are households who have non-zero savings. These are averages. Thank you for your attention. Okay, as I said, when we worked first in 1990, we did not know what Engel did. This I came to know because of some review articles that appeared in 2010. And subsequently, there are articles about Engel's contribution, which appeared in English, which I read. They are all secondary sources, not primary. Then I realized that Engel did what all I did, way back in 1857. So, what I call is KGS and CKM approaches. KGS means Kumar, Gore and Sitarama, we were the three authors of the first paper on poverty without a poverty line in 1994. And the other one is Chattopadhyaya, Kumar and Malik. That is the paper I am now presenting. We have been recently working, three of us. And our approach is as follows. Our approach is based on angel curve. Angel curve is a curve between consumption expenditure and income of a necessity. Angel curves can be drawn for a necessity as well as luxuries. For necessities, it would be concave. For luxuries, it would be convex. So we took only the angel curve for necessities, which is concave. Okay. My co-author, the entire approach that I am talking about, although I have been continuously working from 1991 onwards, the original idea goes to my co-author of the first paper, Sitarama. He was a nutrition scientist, professor of biotechnology at the University of Pune. Before that, he was a biochemist and a scientist at National Institute of Nutrition. And first I came to know him when there was a meeting conducted by the Indian Council of Medical Research, of which Professor P.V. Sukarne, the great Sukarne, was a member and I was a member. And Sitaraman is the one who brought all of us together to advise National Institute of Nutrition on what type of data to collect which would help them in measuring poverty. So at that time, he was working, analyzing the National Sample Survey data, and he found out that the expenditure on cereals and the total expenditure, they follow a curve like this. But his interpretation of that curve was entirely different, not an economist's interpretation. His interpretation was, whenever you inject a compound to an experimental rat in a laboratory, a biochemist inject a compound, a medicine or something, okay, that injected material is absorbed by the bloodstream of that experimental rat by a kind of a proportion. What proportion of the original injected element is absorbed follows a curve like that. For that, the biochemists have an excellent kinetic equilibrium model. It is called Michelson model. So that model has a specification of the function Cy is equal to Vy by K plus Y. So the specification he was using as a biochemist is much different from the angel curve specifications we economists use. Okay, but he has a wonderful rational expectation. Explanation for it. Look at that beautiful thing. The parameter V is the maximum level of consumption. And parameter K is, it is that level of income where one half of the consumption can be obtained. That is K. Okay? And the proportion of consumption out of income is V by K. Those two parameters capture the angel's property beautifully. Angel's concern was proportion of expenditure out of the total income on food. And that is nothing but V by K. Okay. At limiting income as Y tends to zero. Okay. That is a beautiful concept. Not only that, look at the next diagram. If that is the consumption relationship, the consumption deprivation is V minus Cy is consumption deprivation, right? It is the shortfall from the saturation level. Where do they intersect? They intersect at K. That means K is the point where if you call consumption as an effluence function, and consumption deprivation as a poverty, poverty and affluence meet at K. K is that point where poverty and affluence are equal. Okay. So if one wants a separating income, a beautiful data driven without any arbitrary notion of nutrition level, poverty line, my index, your index, etc., is what the data is telling us, that K is a point where consumption deprivation and consumption are equal.
Essentially here what you are saying is,
yeah,
in effect what you are defining poverty as half the maximum consumption.
I am not saying anything.
No, but then the formula does it. Because it will always be V by 2.
Yeah, but we what we would like to do is, we consider all those people who do not save, what is their consumption deprivation. That is what Engel did, that's what we do. We don't use K. I am just telling the property of K is that one. But we are not using it. Okay? So a poverty index can be defined as the proportion, that means out of the saturation level, what proportion is the deprivation. That means I use V as a denominator so that the poverty measure lies between 0 and 1. Okay. So this is how we define poverty without a poverty line in 1994. In an international seminar which I conducted in Bangalore, attended by several people including my professor Eric Thorbeck of the Fox Greer Thorbeck Index. So we presented that and it was not published because no economics journal was publishing it. So we published that in Journal of Statistical Planning and Inference in 1996. There we first published our paper. After that, we did more detailed work using NSS data. We actually did what in 1857, Engel did. Okay. We found a hierarchy in consumption expenditure from NSS data. We found that, for example, in round 3, the first commodity that saturates is cereal. All these rounds, the first commodity that saturates is cereals. Cereal is the one that saturates first. And then FL is fuel and light. CL is clothing. Okay. FL I don't remember right now. It was done in 1996. Beg to be excused, right, for my not recollecting what it is. Work was done in 96. Okay. So this is the hierarchy, and cereal comes out as the one that saturates first. That is why we chose cereal consumption deprivation as a poverty index without a poverty line. That is what we did. We found that for various rounds of NSS data, R square is very high. We estimated V and K. That is our paper in 1996, Economic and Political Weekly. Okay. Then, in 2007, see, from my introduction you may have seen, I retired in 1999. I was going to United States to visit my children. On the way, I stopped in London to visit my student who was a professor at the University of London. He said, "Professor Kumar, you have done this work and nobody is working, let us work on it." So he said, then he and I came together and he got micro level data at the household level on electronic tapes, the electronic data from NSS. Earlier we used the group data. The previous table, based on the group data of income and expenditure, later we got like household level data, even at each individual level data, we use that data to redo the whole analysis. And we published that paper, Malik and I, with another PhD student of mine at IIM Bangalore, Jayaram Bulla, three of us wrote a paper published in Journal of Development Studies in 2009. In that paper, which is a very lengthy paper, we did state-wise, round-wise analysis of real data from India. We did poverty estimation without a poverty line. That was a major study. In that study, what we did was, for angel curve, we used various angel curves specified by economists. One is Allen and Bowley, other is Working and Lesser, Modified Working and Lesser, Trace Houghaker, Banks, Bundle and Duval, and Kumar, Gore and Shindarama, our specification. The beauty is, when we did all that in that paper, we found our specification was the best fitting specification among all those. Okay.
Can you explain what do you mean by best fitting specification in this?
Best fitting in terms of R square.
So
R square and minimum errors and normally distributed errors. We got for that specification perfectly symmetrically normally distributed errors with minimum variance. What I did was, we also found out, given all those specifications, what is the maximum R square among all of them? If at all our thing was not the maximum, what is the shortfall? You can see the shortfall is very, very, very small. Then came our, in the meantime, I have been working on other things, or not working, but my student, Malik, started working with my other co-author, Chattopadhyaya. Chattopadhyaya is a professor of applied physics in Ashton University in Birmingham. So he showed interest in economic modeling. So he and Malik wrote a paper on an agent-based model of a market economy. That is like a multiple market exchange equilibrium model or something like that, market economy, and then used a physics model. They actually used a Brownian motion. Suppose there are several economic agents, all of them interact with each other, okay? Then the analogy was, it is like a particle in a bowl of water. Each particle has a motion in that bowl of water, okay? And that motion is described by Brownian motion. Okay. Each particle is within a body of, so they say each economic agent is an element like a particle of a water in a body. So using that analogy, they use the physics model of the Brownian motion to describe the income and consumption in an economy. And they got beautiful results using the same data that we use, NSS data. They got a very good fit. Then I joined the picture and then said, look, that model has to be integrated with our poverty model, because the problem with our poverty model or with all the poverty models is that they are disjoint from the mainstream economics, microeconomics and macroeconomics. So let us put them together, was my suggestion. So that is resulted in the present version of the paper. We assume that there are two markets, one for assets human capital, physical and financial capital, and another for goods and services that are consumed. We assume that each person enters the pool of other persons who are already there in each of these two markets. This is the standard agent-based model that is quite familiar to economists. Given our assumption of an art, so we also assume an adaptive behavior. Okay, it's not now economics, there is another branch you may have heard it, ecological economics, where we talk about behavior being adaptive. Okay, so again, this is started after the behavioral economics Nobel Prize. Okay, after that, people are shifting to behavioral economics. Okay, so we assume that people adopt to a say the common community behavior between consumption and income is given by the Engel curve. Everybody knows how other people are spending given their income levels and they want to ape them. See, in my income group, what are the others consuming? I would like to consume the same thing. If my income is something which I consume something, whereas others are consuming a bit more, I would like to consume like them a bit more. How? By getting more income. So I try to adapt my income level to the desired income level of somebody who is better than me. Okay. And once an income is given, I would like to consume like what the community consumes. That is the adaptive behavior we have in the model. Okay. So this is the Langevin equation of physics that we use in economics. We assume that the income grows. Everybody tries to increase his income from the original level, trying to reach a desired level, but reaches only a fraction of it. Actually, beta times a desired level. And then whenever income is whenever there is a positive savings, that savings goes, there is a less incentive to increase income. That's why the negative term. If there is savings, there is less incentive to increase the income. And then there is a random term, that is the Brownian motion, the random stochastic term there. So this is the dynamics of income. That is the physics analogy model. And then this is again derived from the previous physics model, what is called a Poisson-Planck equation, that describes, and the steady state solution of that is given by this. This is a steady state solution of that entire dynamic model. So we do that and we use NSS data from 1959 to 2002, spanning 43 years. Nationwide sample survey data, these are obtained from World Bank poverty data. See, these are the fits we get for the income distribution for various rounds. 1974, 83 and 91, three rounds, we are showing the actual data and the fitted curve. Get extremely good fit for the model.
So in income here is total consumption,
right? Huh?
Income is total consumption,
right? Total consumption. Total expenditure.
Total expenditure.
Income is proxied by total expenditure.
So there is no component for saving.
For savings in this one. I'll come to that. Thank you for raising that point. I'll come to that. That's a proxy in this model. That's a weakness. I come to that. Then we notice that the saturation level of consumption is declining over time. Okay. And the income needed to have half of saturation, that is K, is also declining over time.
That would mean that inequality is rising. That would mean that inequality is rising. There is more inequality.
No, it's only says, actually the second one is related to the first one. whenever V is declining, K also will decline, because V by 2 is purchased at K. Okay, when V is declining, K also has to decline. It derives from that. There's nothing special about it. Okay? Now here, if the CPI normalized mean income versus time, we notice that mean income had declined up to a particular point, and then mean income started increasing after a point. Actually, we notice this even in our earlier paper in JDS, Journal of Development Studies. We notice this. This is because until the 5th 5-year plan, the focus of development planning was on growth, not on equity. After 5th 5-year plan, it is some poverty attention and equity with growth was the focus. And hence, the mean income started increasing after that. Okay? So that is an option.
The saturation level was decreasing. What would be the reason for that? I mean, these are the basic essential needs.
There are several reasons. Unfortunately, we did not examine, and many people have not examined, but there are some papers which say that the commercialization of agriculture and the high-yielding variety introduction into agriculture had resulted in replacing the coarse grains by high-priced grains, which meant that the cereal consumption by the poor is reduced, because they could not, that totally gone out of the market to a lot of people. Okay, they could not go and buy the higher-priced grain in the market. Okay, price has gone up, they could not afford it. So their consumption had gone down. That is one explanation. Okay. And this is the Engel law, that CY by Y is declining. And then we compare the headcount index, poverty gap index, and this is poverty without CD dynamic and with CD dynamics. So the advantage of our index is, because it is a dynamic model, given the income and consumption up to one particular point, because of the dynamic model, we can predict what will be the next year's income and consumption. And given the consumption deprivation up to this point, what will be the consumption deprivation next year or two? We can predict that from the model. So ours is a predictive model of the poverty also, whereas the others are not.
So regarding this analysis of data, they capture the consumption expenditure. They capture the consumption expenditure household level. Household level consumption expenditure is captured by analysis of data. Mm. That kind of data is captured and reported by analysis.
Yeah, I'd answer that. So our model is that human capital is exchanged for wages and salaries, commodities are exchanged for money income. I mentioned all this before. And this is the Engel curve we got from the data. I showed this before. Now comes some of the still incomplete and some researchable questions that still remain ahead are, as you were talking about, here we are talking about total expenditure as a proxy for income. On one hand, I had already said that we want to use the cutoff point as zero savings. Okay. But this database includes all. Okay. Recently, as a reviewer, I have reviewed some papers in a special journal of Human Development Journal of Human Development. I have reviewed a few papers where they examine the national survey data on assets. One can combine the assets data, assets and wealth data with income and expenditure data, splice them together and build one database, okay, where in this database, wherever there is positive savings, match that with asset data, combine one database and then cut off at zero savings and examine consumption deprivation at zero savings using the splice data is something that needs to be done, because this is inadequate otherwise.
So, for example, I mean, so let us say we want to see consumption of milk, just an example, and corresponding asset to it be the population of cows, proxy. So how would you go about, so we have population from census, and then we have consumption of milk from the NSS data. So how do we...
What I mean is, if I am using as a poverty index, consumption deprivation of milk, I should consider consumption deprivation of milk of all those people who do not have a cow. We should not use the people who have cow as an asset, because they do not belong to that low level category.
So this cannot be done at the aggregate level.
Whereas our study did not separate that. It included whatever is there with NSS data, we used all of that. Okay. To be really reflective of Engel's idea of what is called a comfortable level of income, you should combine those two, generate a database, and then say those households which have zero level of saving or more than zero saving, they should be excluded from the poverty studies. Okay. That is something we are planning to do. If anybody else does it faster than us, good luck. Okay. If any of you wants to do that. Okay. We are already on it. So I welcome any questions at this stage. I must admit that I am a bit hard of hearing, so if you raise your hand, I will come close to you to hear your question. I didn't get your question.
So here we are showing variation of consumption with respect to income.
So where
from we got income level data?
Income level data. It's not income. It's total expenditure data. That was his question.
So total
expenditure is taken as a proxy for income in this study. But one can combine income tax data and asset data from the National Sample Survey, etc., to bridge a database for income and consumption. Okay. But the problem with that is, if you use income tax data, the reliability of that is compared to total expenditure is very poor, because a lot of cheating takes place with income tax, because that does not take place with consumption level data. Okay.
Here also, I mean, if I'm not wrong, we are trying to match the level of asset with respect to consumption, so that the saving is zero. We are trying to arrive at that equation.
So are we
assuming that whatever source of asset that we have identified at the household level will lead to some kind of consumption increase?
Not necessarily.
Yeah.
See, the basic idea is, the more asset income, more savings there is, the less of it would go to consumption. It would go to creation of more assets. The higher asset income, the higher is the tendency to buy other assets or luxuries. It doesn't go into consumption of necessities. That is the reason why we want to cut our sample at zero savings, because our focus is on the essential commodities, consumption of essential commodities. And people who have positive savings have greater tendency to consume luxuries rather than essentials. That is the reason.
Yeah, sometimes it might also happen that people have asset, but it might not reflect in increase in consumption because of some rigidity in kind of liquidating that asset.
Yeah.
In like how we can say that having asset leads to increase in consumption is proportional increase in consumption.
Okay, that issue is on a temporary basis. Yes, having positive assets may not really result in an increase in consumption. It goes to pay back the debt that is already incurred. If that is the argument, then what I am saying must be done not with respect to 1 year, but over a range of years, so that that effect is nullified. Okay. Zero savings not in 1 year, but zero savings on the average over 5 year period. Then it captures the real meaning. Right?
So in, for the Indian data, we use cereals is the first commodity to get saturated.
Okay.
For the data from India, cereals is the first commodity that gets saturated and then comes down. But how about other countries?
That's a very interesting question also.
Vegetarian countries
versus... I tell you our experience. For our JDS paper, General of Development Studies paper, when we were doing, we noticed that cereal consumption goes like this, up to a point,
and then goes up. It goes down.
No, and then goes up. Okay? The reason is, that there are certain cereal products,
meat,
okay, which are made by Amul and marketed at a high price, sweets, okay.
No, but for that matter, even meat, for example.
Yeah.
So to grow poultry, they use grains.
Poultry could be a necessity, and other meat should be luxury.
No, what I'm saying is, rather than humans consuming the cereals, they are feeding the cereals to the animals,
right.
And the humans are consuming animals, and it is a much more inefficient way to get nutrition. So even though the consumption of cereal is going up, but I mean at an aggregate level, but it's actually the consumption of it's disguised cereal in the form of meat.
Anyway, this is another dimension to question that was raised earlier. Part of the reason why cereal consumption is going down could be those cereals are diverted to the animal husbandry business as a feed.
Right.
It's not going for human consumption.
Right.
That's a possibility too.
But so I tried to map some of the data of cereal consumption and animal source food consumption. So what we see is that with rising incomes, the cereal consumption goes down, and that of animal source foods, so that includes dairy, meat, fish, that goes up.
Right.
And dairy is something, so milk is something which across income classes, it keeps going up.
Yeah.
So even a rich man or a poor man, their consumption of milk
increases. So, if you take this point, we have observed earlier that the saturation level is going down for cereals is actually possibly not a reflection of lower level of living. It could be a reflection of higher level of living,
right,
of people substituting better products than cereal in their consumption basket. Okay. So I'm not examining all those things. Okay. That's a possibility too. That is all the more reason why the poverty index study should be related to the general economics than simply giving an index. Then you can examine all these issues. Is that decline due to this or due to that? You can examine all those only if you relate them to the rest of the market economy.
So, like with your model, you said that the advantage is that we can predict the future. know, so 2-3 years.
Yeah.
Now, let us say the government takes corrective action and then there is, then the curve will not, the, so what your model does, it shifts the curve dynamically.
Right.
Right. So it is bound to fit the data best. That's why you have, you know, highest R squares. But then implication for policy making, you know, because policy needs stability. So they need some metric to hold on to over maybe at least 3 to 5 years period.
Yeah.
Rather than that metric itself moving about.
Again, you see, there are so many limitations of the approach and so many possible extensions that can be made. For example, in all this, we have not introduced state intervention. See, for example, the agent-based model is a market exchange model. It does not take into account state intervention. Okay. So if you modify the model to introduce state intervention, okay, then naturally that state intervention parameter would be a part of our dynamic model. When it is a part of dynamic model, the state intervention will also come into the picture of prediction. Okay, it will say if state intervenes, this will be the outcome. If it does not intervene, this will be the outcome. So these are limitations and areas where the model needs to be extended for better results, for better policy prescription. Thank you.